Hello and assalamu alaikum. I hope that all of you will be fine and doing great. So this is the lecture 5 continuation, and in this lecture I will discuss about the sources of energy, which include renewable energy sources, non-renewable energy sources and the secondary sources. So first of all, we will discuss about the non-renewable energy sources. The non-renewable energy sources include crude oil, petroleum products, hydrocarbon, natural gas, coal and nuclear energy. Non-renewable energy comes out from the sources that will run out or will not be replenished in our lifetimes. Most of the renewable energy sources includes the example that are listed in this slide. Renewable energy sources include biomass such as ethanol, hydropower, wind, solar energy, biomass, and the energy generated from the plants and animals. And the third one was a secondary energy. Secondary energy comes from the resources that are converted from the primary sources, which include solid fuels and gas like soy gas. Now let's discuss about the crude oil and the petroleum products. Crude oil is naturally occurring unrefined petroleum product that is composed of basically hydrocarbons, deposits and other organic materials. These are a type of fossil fuels. Crude oil can be refined to produce usable products such as diesel, petrol and other forms of petrochemicals. The fuels are examples like butane, fuel oil, gasoline, kerosene, LNG and LPG. They exist in liquid form in underground pools and reservoirs and in tiny spaces between the sedimentary rocks. They are near the surface in tar or in the oil form in sands. Refineries separate the crude oil into usable products that I have mentioned earlier. Now let's discuss about the petroleum products. Fuel made from crude oil and other hydrocarbons contained in natural gas, they can be made from coal and biomass. So this is the chart of the products and byproducts that we get in one barrel or 42 gallons of petroleum or crude oil. So there are 20 gallons of gasoline, Hydrocarbon gas liquids are 2 gallons. Heavy fuel oil residues are approximately 1 gallon. Other petroleum products like petroleum jelly or Vaseline, they are nearly 6 gallon. Jet fuel is about 4 gallon. Heating oil example and other distilled products are less than 1 gallon, and the remaining 11 gallons are ultra low sulfur distillates. So this is the graph of top 5 crude oil producing countries, and their time span is ranging from 1980 to 2017. The first one, the green one, is USSR. USSR stands for Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, and their graph was on the top in early 90s, and then from early 90s onward it fell down, and Saudi Arabia was the top producer of crude oil. Now again this graph is up as compared to Saudi Arabia. The other oil producing countries, their graph is also on the increase because of the increasing demand of energy that is being generated from fossil fuel based products. Now let us discuss the uses of crude oil and petroleum products. The first one is gasoline, most commonly known in Pakistan as petrol. It is used in cars, recreational vehicles, boats, small aircraft, in equipment of constructions, farming, forestry, landscaping, and in portable generators. Diesel is used in transportation, tanks used by military, and diesel engine generators like the one we have in our university. The next one is heating oil, which is often used in residences for space and water heating. Nowadays it is being replaced with natural gas like sui gas in Pakistan, and by electricity we use electric heaters. Also we use inverter based air conditioners for heating and cooling purposes. Now let's discuss about the hydrocarbons gas liquids, commonly known as HGL. Hydrocarbons, these are the molecules of carbon and hydrogen in various combinations. HGL or hydrocarbons, which are converted in gases at atmospheric pressure and when stored in high pressure containers, by cooling them down we convert them first into liquid. They are categorized as light or heavy according to the number of carbon and hydrogen atoms in one molecule of HGL. They are found in raw natural gas and crude oil. And basically, they are categorized as paraffins or olefins. Paraffins are known as alkanes, which are saturated compounds. They have a straight chain molecular structure. The most common example is, methane. The methane, ethane, propane, butane, these series. These series are known as paraffins. And the other ones is olefins. They are also alkenes and made up of hydrogen and carbon that contain one or more pairs of carbon atoms linked via double bond, or in chemistry we call it covalent bond. Olefins are examples of unsaturated hydrocarbons which contains only hydrogen and carbons and at least one double or triple bond. So the main difference between olefin and paraffin is that paraffin has a straight chain and the olefins have at least one or double triple bonded structure attached to them via covalent bond. Now this is the graph of United States hydrocarbon gas liquid production from year 2000 to 2017. The blue one lines show the petroleum refining and the brown one is the natural gas processing. Over time, it can be seen from the graph that natural gas processing has been increased because of higher efficiency rates. This is the graph of US hydrocarbon gas liquid production by type from year 2008 to 2017, and this graph indicates that olefins and paraffins trends are rapidly increasing over time. Now we will discuss about the uses of HGL. The first use is a feedstock in petroleum plants to make chemicals, plastic, and synthetic rubber. The second one is the fuel for heating, cooking, and drying. Also, these are the fuels used for transportation purposes and additives for motor gasoline production. Also, they are used as a thinning agents, like the thinner used in paints, and for transportation of heavy crude oil. They basically use these thinners to dilute the crude oil, so their volume increases and the overall weight is reduced and it is easy for transportation. The next comes natural gas. Natural gas is formed deep beneath the earth's crust. In Pakistan, we have gas reservoirs at Sui. These reservoirs usually contain many compounds, and the one which is most abundant in them is methane. In our gas ovens, we are burning methane. The methane actually has no smell, and the smell is added by the gas refineries. Natural gas also contains small number of NGL, natural gas liquids. They have included hydrocarbon liquid gas and non-hydrocarbon liquid gases, which include water vapors and carbon dioxide. There are four types of natural gases. The first one is the natural gas that is majorly found in the cracks and spaces between the layers overlying rock. The next is the shale gas or the tight gases found in the tiny pores or spaces within some formations of sandstone, shale, and other types of sedimentary rocks. The third one is associated natural gas found with deposits of crude oil. And the last one is coal bed methane, which is found in coal mines or coal deposits. So this is the illustration of the formation of petroleum and gas. The first picture depicts that marine mammals, animals, and plants which die in the ocean are buried on the ocean floor, covered by silt and sand. Over millions of years, the layers of sand, silt and sand expand, and the high pressure converts those animal and plants remain into the reservoirs of oil and natural gas. This is the schematic geology of natural gas resources. This is the top land surface, and in small depths, these are coal bed methane reservoirs. These are conventional non-associated gases, and down deep are the gas-rich shales, along with are the tight gases that are trapped in sandstone. These are the oil reservoirs, and these are the reservoirs of conventional associated gases. So this is the chart that explains the natural gas production and its delivery to the consumer. First of all, oil and gas is extracted from the reservoirs. The oil is separated and the water is separated and the gas is given to the processing plant. The byproducts are removed and the methane is concentrated at compressor stations. Then the odorant is added and the natural gas company distributes it via lines and via LNG cylinders to the consumers. So this chart can be divided in three parts. The first part is the production part, the second one is the transmission part, and third, the final part, is the distribution part. LNG or liquefied natural gas. LNG is cooled to liquid state at about minus 260 degree Fahrenheit for shipping purposes and storage. So by converting it into a liquid state, its volume decreases to about 600 times and it is easier for transportation purposes. There are special ocean ships and tankers that are used for the transportation purpose of liquid natural gas or LNG. The uses of LNG include power plant store and use these to generate electricity when the electricity demand exceeds the natural gas pipeline delivery capacity. These are the containers of LNG which are basically put on a large ship, and the ship is in ocean. So this is the way the LNG containers are transported from one country to another. The next come the coal. The coal has basically four main types, and these types are classified according to their carbon content. The first one is the anthracite, which contains about 86 to 97% carbon and have the highest heating value. This type of coal is mainly used by the industries which use the heat energy of coal to melt down metals. Now the next one is bituminous, which contains about 45 to 86% carbon, and they are basically used to generate electricity and also as an important fuel and raw material for making iron and steel. The next one is subbituminous, which contain 35 to 45% carbon, and the last one, the most important one, is lignite, which contains about 25 to 35% carbon and it has lowest energy content. This is basically used to synthesize natural gas, and in making barbecues. So this chart explains that how coal is formed. Over millions of years, when the plants decay and die, and these plants are covered with dirt and sand, and the pressure of ocean is pressing them down, all this pressure and heat converts this dead plant in coal. The primary usage of coal is in power plants, which make steam by burning coal, and steam turns the turbine to generate electricity. The next use is in the cement industry and in paper industry for the production of heat. Steel industries indirectly use coal to make steel. High temperatures are created by burning coal, which give steel strength and flexibility, which is needed to form bridges, buildings, and automobiles. Coal is also converted into gases or liquids called syn fuels, which produce lower air pollutants than burning coal itself. So this is your exercise. You have to analyze this graph, which basically illustrates the coal consumption from year 1950 to 2017 by major end users. Most of the coal is used in electricity production. The remaining graph is your exercise, and you should analyze it thoroughly.